Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Lakmini Abhisurya from Building Services Engineering Sectional Committee. I warmly welcome you all to the fourth webinar organized by the Building Services Engineering Sectional Committee for the session 2019-2020. Thank you all for taking a valuable time out and being here with us today. Our guest speaker today is Engineer Sajiva Pereira, who will be talking to you on the importance of proper selection of centrifugal pumps and their applications in the building sector. When it comes to building sector, pump is a crucial component in many applications, and it is worth to know how to select the most suitable pump. Therefore, today's lecture will be focused on the pump selection based on the key parameters and their applications to have a trouble-free system. Now, let me introduce our speaker tonight, Engineer Sajiva Pereira. He obtained his bachelor's degree from University of Moratuwa, specialized in mechanical engineering, followed by a postgraduate diploma in building services engineering from University of Moratuwa. Engineer Sajiva is a member of Institution of Engineers Sri Lanka and also a member of Lanka Association of Building Services Engineers Sri Lanka. He has served as a resource person for many of the CPD courses organized by the Building Services Engineering Sectional Committee and some of the short courses organized by ICTAD related to pumps and pumping systems in building sector. Ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, please join with me to welcome our speaker tonight, Engineer Sajiva Pereira. One special announcement. Please note that we will be running a live Q&A session at the end of the presentation. You may mute your microphones and videos until then. While the presentation is going on, you can post your questions to the moderator through chat. You can find the chat option at the bottom of your screen if you are logged from a laptop. Depending on the time, we will direct your questions to the speaker at the end of the presentation. Now, let's move to the presentation. Over to you, sir.
Thank you very much, Lakmini, for the introduction about me and the lecture content of this today's lecture. So I will start my presentation. So okay. So I hope everybody can see the presentation. Okay. So it's really a challenge for me to squeeze the presentation for 1 hour, discuss all about the pump. Okay, but I will do my best to give the maximum possible for you to understand better about the centrifugal pumps and its applications. Okay, so I will straight away move to the basic classification of centrifugal pump. Let's say if you take a centrifugal pump, which can be divided into four main categories, like overhang, the between bearing, vertically suspended and submersible motor. It's basically based on the construction, how the pump has been constructed. So you will see the difference between these four categories. It's all about how the pump has been, I would say, the shaft and the impeller has been mounted in that. So if you go by each and every category, so overhang pump, we call it flexible couple pump. So this is commonly used in every application in the building sector. So it is also can be divided into another two segment, like horizontal and the vertical, and another foot mounted, center line mounted, inline bearing frame. So by picture you will get an understanding about the pump and how that construction has been done. I will elaborate further on this one by one in the latter part of my presentation. And the second is the between bearing pumps. So it's the name itself gives you a better understanding how it has been mounted. So you will see the impeller has been mounted in between two bearings. So it can be one or two stage, like you see in the pictures below. And it can be more than two stages. It is the same you will see on the bottom of that picture. And the other category is vertically suspended pumps. This is not much familiar with the building sector, except few, I would say few pumping insulation, which is mainly used for the intake water supply, where you will get the water from river, or if you have any difficulties in getting the water from the negative suction, you may use this type of pumps, where the pump part will be submerged in the water and the motor will be mounted on top. So that that is what we call vertically suspended pumps. And the last one is the submersible motor pumps. It can be discharge tube type or the tank type and the borehole type. So these are the main four categories when you classify the centrifugal pumps as a general, right? Okay. So we'll go to the most detailed one about the application and how the pump has been manufactured and constructed based on these wordings. If anybody has an idea about the type of pumps that is used in the building applications, the most commonly used pump is the end suction back pull out type pump. The main concern of this, why I wanted this to be highlighted, because though we always talk about this end suction, back pull out, and whatever the names mentioned there, sometimes we may not very much aware about what exactly that does it mean, right? So I will show you a sort of a video where you will get a better understanding about the pump and how that name came for that particular model. So you will see it is called end suction back pull out type. So it can be long couple or the close couple. Okay, we'll go to the video and you will get a better understanding about why we call it end suction back pull out. Okay, now you will see the pump and the motor will be connected with the coupling, and the backside of the pump can be taken out from the system without disturbing the pipeline. Okay, so I will run it again. End suction, the water will be sucking from the end. You will see over here from the end, and the end suction back pull out. The back part of the pump can be pulled out. So, can everybody see the presentation?
Not really, we cannot see it.
Oh, what is the problem?
Video we can't see.
Wait, I will share the video again.
Only we can see the arrows only, not the details.
No, check it again. Can anybody see the presentation now?
Yes.
We can see the presentation.
Yes. Okay.
We can see the presentation, but not the video.
Okay, I will run the video again just to make sure that everybody can watch it. I will run it again. Okay, can you see it now?
Yeah, now we can.
Yes.
Okay, you will see that pump, how the pump has been dismantled. Yeah, that gives you a better understanding how, what is the meaning that gives with the end suction. You will see that pump will be sucking, the water will be sucking from end, and the backside of the pump can be pulled out from the system. That is what we call end suction back pull out, right? You will see the motor and the pump will be coupled by means of a flexible coupling. And if you want to remove the entire pumping part from the system, you can take that particular part from the pipe pumps from the end, the back pull out from the backside. So that is why we call it end suction back pull out system. Right, so it's the name came for the this particular pump called end suction back pull out type. Okay. Right. Okay. The other one is we call it the same thing with spacer coupling. There you will see the without spacer coupling and with spacer coupling. It is the same design, but only difference is having another spacer in between the pump and the motor. Okay, you will see in between the pump and the motor, you will see a spacer coupling where that particular space can be created with the spacer coupling so that you don't want to move the motor in order to remove the pump part from the system. So that is the advantage that you get with the spacer coupling. The previous one, in order to remove the pump part, you may have to move the motor as well. Now you can do it without moving the motor, but removing the spacer coupling from the system. Okay. So I'm taking little bit of time for this video just to give you a better understanding about the different pumps and how that will be differentiate with the other models for you to get a better understanding about it. Now we will move to the close couple one. It's again the same principles. Only difference is there is no any coupling in between. It's a close couple where it will directly couple with the motor. So I will show it to you. This is here. Here you will see that is the same design, end suction back pullout. There is no difference in end suction back pullout, but it's close coupled, where the pump, the motor and the pump is coupled with a rigid coupling, so that the motor and the pump part both has to be taken from the system for the any maintenance and repair work. But it's again end suction. No need to dismantle the suction pipe or the discharge pipe. It's a matter of taking the entire motor and the pump part from the system. Okay. So the other one is vertical inline single stage pump. It's vertical inline. The mounting arrangement is vertical. The flow direction is inline. That is what we call vertical inline. So I will show that also. Okay, you will see it. You can see the connection, how the connection has been done. It's inline. The suction and the delivery is inline. Okay, and the pump has been mounted vertically. The motor will be mounted vertically so that you can remove the pump, entire pumping system from the system without disturbing the pipeline. That is we call vertical single stage inline, only a single impeller in the pump. We call it vertical inline pump. Okay, right. And next, is a horizontal split casing pumps. This is not commonly used in every application, but mainly used in a fire application as well as high flow rate. If you want to deliver high flow rate, so these horizontal split casing pumps are commonly used for the water distribution system, especially for the national water supply project. So we are always refer high capacity to be pumped to the system. You always refer to split casing, and that name also comes with the construction of that pump. So that is, we'll show you that. Okay, you can see it. Split casing, inline split casing. You can see the casing can be splitted into two. That is why we call it split casing inline double suction. Sometimes people might misunderstand when it's called double suction. There's no any suction to entering point for the pump, but you have two passages in the suction line where that is called double suction inline split casing pumps. The pump can be splitted, the casing can be splitted into two. That is why we call it double suction split casing pump. So that name has been given for the pump based on the construction and the way it's dismantled from the system. So that is why we call it split casing pump. Okay. Okay, and the last one, it is horizontal multi-stage pump. That is, that again give you a better understanding. It is installed in horizontally, and you have multi-stage where you will have more than one impeller inside the pump. With that, you will get high pressure where each and every impeller will get the pressure increase, and you will get a higher pressure from the outlet. So if you want to get much higher pressure, you may have to increase the number of impellers inside the pump. So that is why we call it horizontal multi-stage pump that again used in high pressure application mainly. So okay, you will see this is the multi-stage. Every intermediate casing you will have a impeller inside, and the other advantage that you get with this multi-stage horizontal one, you can turn the suction and delivery flange whatever the direction you wish to have, depending on the pump house piping arrangement. You may have the facility to change the direction of the suction flange and the delivery flange as per the requirement in the pumping house, right? So these are the commonly used pump you will come across these models in your application. And the last one is vertical multi-stage pump. It is the pump which you can see from the presentation itself. This one is the vertical multi. It's the same principle. You have multiple impellers inside the pump house, but it will be vertically mounted, and this particular pump will be used for the high pressure application and low flow rate mainly, and for the booster stations, booster package that is normally commonly used with this pump. And these are the main pumps that you will come across in a building application. In addition to these, there may be different type of pump, but very rarely used in the building sector. Okay, so I will move to the main important parameters in selecting the pump. Okay, so normally when we select a pump, only two parameters mainly required. One is the head. We call it pressure, but it's a conversion of sort of a specific gravity is required in order to convert the pressure into head. So when you know the pressure required, you can divide it by the specific gravity, you will get the head. So head and the pressure is interconnected with that. And if you take heads, there are many type of heads that you have heard about, each and every head in a system. These are really required when you do a sort of a calculation. When you calculate the entire requirement of the head, you may need all these the wordings that is concerned in order to calculate the total head requirement. That can be static suction head, static discharge head, friction head, vapor pressure head, velocity head, and total suction head, total discharge head, total differential head, and the most importantly, net positive suction head. All these are head. It will be denoted by meters, right? Out of all these, I'm going to touch only the important two or three parameters because of the time limited. So I am going to give you the most important head requirement. The first is the total suction head, where whenever you install a pump, before to install it, you have to calculate the total suction head. That has to be calculated based on this. You need to know the pressure head in suction reservoir and static suction head, the difference between the water level and the center line of the pump, and the velocity head. The velocity, you will have to refer the velocity in order to calculate that, and the friction head through the pipeline up to the suction flange. You need to take all these things into consideration and you will get the value that is called total suction head, right? And the other one is the total discharge head, that the same components that has to be considered from the discharge flange up to the exit point. You may have to consider each and every head and calculate that, you will get that particular value. So you now you have the suction head and the discharge head. So if you consider the total differential head, that is the difference between the discharge head and the head and the total suction head. In any particular pump, if somebody, even the one, whatever the manufacturer, if they say the head, pump head, that is the differential head will be measured by this particular pump. Not the suction, not the delivery. It's the combination of these, the difference between the suction and the delivery. So keep that in mind. This particular case, if it is a negative suction insulation, where you will get the negative value as total suction head, right? That is when you know the total discharge head, let's say it's about 20 meter, and the total suction head, right? That is again a minus value, and when you add together, it will be plus minus. Minus, it will be plus. So you will get a higher. Similarly, you have to find the differential head, the way that has to be based on the suction and the delivery. Now you know the how to calculate the differential head. And the other important parameter is the capacity. So it can be denoted by cubic meters power, gallons per minute, liters per minute, liters per second, whatever the way, it's the capacity. Two parameters, one is the head, other one is the capacity. So if you take the capacity, it can be vary based on the liquid characteristic, pump size, impeller size, rotational speed, all these things will be the factor for the capacity. So those two parameters, Q and H, capacity and the head, is the most important parameters to select the pump, right? This is something very much known to everybody, but I just wanted you to give that particular information before to go into the most important part of selecting this particular pump. Right. So if you know the particular pump's Q and the head, it is easy for you to calculate the liquid power delivered by the pump by means of a small equation like this. If you know the Q and the head, you have to make sure this particular unit has to be considered. If you take the Q, it should be cubic meters power. If it is head, make sure to put it as meters. Then you will get the value, specific gravity almost close to one for the water. If it is the temperature is difference, you will get a slightly different specific gravity even for the water, but it is almost one, I would say. So then you know the Q and you know the H, and you can calculate, multiply Q by H and divide it by 367. You will get the value, that is the power, liquid power delivered by the pump. So for the anybody who is doing sort of a calculation to calculate the power requirement of the system, you can easily get that particular information without even getting any technical of the pump manufacturer or the pump. It is not really required for you to get that particular power requirement. But that is not the actual power consumed by the pump, because you have to consider efficiency as well, efficiency of the pump. So that is what we call mechanical power delivered to the pump shaft. That means when you If you are to deliver this particular power to the system, you may have to supply that particular power to the pump by the motor. So then the motor has to be delivered sort of a power, and that power has to be considered as the input for the pump, where the efficiency will take a vital role in that particular case. So if you want to get the mechanical power delivered to the pump shaft, you may have to divide that particular value which you have already calculated in the previous equation and divide it by the efficiency. Let's say the efficiency of the pump is 70 percent. So you have to divide it by 0.7, right? So you have to approximate it basically. Taking 70% as efficiency would be fair enough, because you better not to take a higher efficiency value so that you will get a lower kilowatt. That will not be the actual kilowatt required by this particular pump. So better to be sort of a lower side, make it as 70 or 65% as efficiency, just to get approximate kilowatt value of that particular design. Not to get the actual value. In order to get the actual, you have to refer the pump curve and you have to get the efficiency from that particular curve. I'm talking about to have an idea about the approximate power requirement, you can get it from that. And it's the pump efficiency, it's the other way around, it's the kilowatt, that is WKW divided by DKW, that equation, when you divided these two, you will get the efficiency. If you really want to get that particular efficiency, you will also can get it in that way. And so it's graphical way you will see. This is what I already explained to you in the previous slide. The power P4 is the water power delivered by the pump. And P3 is equal to P2 because the shaft power given by the motor is equal to the shaft power needed to drive the pump, right? And if you want to calculate the electrical power needed to drive motor, then you have to divide that particular P1 from that particular motor efficiency. Yeah, you will get the P2 value. You have to divide it by the efficiency of the motor, then you will get the power required by the motor for that, right? Okay, now I will show you a typical pump performance curve with the combination of other parameters which you could gain from the particular pump curve. You will see this is the information which you could get easily from the pump curve. You will see there are few curves over here. This is the basic one, that is the pump curve against Q and the head. You will see the head from there. The red color one is denoted by the head. Then again, you will get another curve, the efficiency curve, right? This is the efficiency curve, right? And this is the power curve. So whenever you refer to one particular performance curve, all this information should be there. And the NPSH curve, right? So NPSH, I will come to that particular point later. So it's another important parameter, but these information would be able to gain, or you would be able to taken from this pump curve. Okay. So then if you take for any particular pump, you will have only one maximum efficient point, that is called best efficiency point. For any particular pump, only one best efficient point, and all the other point in that particular curve are lower than that particular efficiency point. So if you take the particular point, if it is the best efficiency point, corresponding value over here, it's like this. And if you move that particular duty point towards this way or that way, you will see the efficiency may drop. Efficiency may drop, right? Then it's keep that in mind, always need to select the pump that duty point is always somewhat closer to the best efficiency point, because it is not always possible for you to have the duty point on the best efficiency point. It's really not easy. You may able to do it, not all the time, but sometimes you may able to do that. And another two points that is highlighted here, this is the point where you will not get any flow, that is called no flow. And that no flow condition will be achieved by closing the delivery valve completely. That is called shut off head, where no flow will be delivered by the pump. Shut off head point. And this particular point is a runout point, where from out of that particular point, you will not be able to, predict anything, because it will deliver very high flow and NPSH is going to be very high, and you will get a lot of issues with that if you run the pump out of this particular point, right? So these are the main information that you could gain from a pump, right? This is the graphical, this thing, and actual curve of a pump. When you select a pump, you will see the actual appearance of a pump curve with the information in the pump itself. You will get a lot of information. Just have a look on this. And if you take one particular model, this is, let's say, pump one model, where you will see lot of curves in that, right? Lot of curves in that. That means in one particular model, there can be different diameters can be achieved with that particular model. So you will see that if you select a pump, in this case, I have select a pump for the flow rate of 130 cubic meters per hour, and the head is 30 meters. Right, where you will be given the particular point over here, and it's near to that particular point, you will see a red line like this. Okay, I hope everyone see this graph, right? Can everybody see this?
Yes, we can.
Okay. This is the best efficiency line, where this is the best efficiency point of that particular pump curve. As I explained to you before, there can be only one best efficient point in the pump curve. This is the red line where you will get the best efficiency point. So that particular duty point would be little towards the left side of that particular curve, because that is the more close point where you will be selected with this particular model. Okay. And at the same time, you will see a different millimeter values over here. Let's say this is 174, 169, 166, different diameter. That means even with the same model, even with a single model, you will be able to get a different diameter pump depending on your duty point. Right. The most important thing is this: whenever you select the pump, you have to make sure you should not select the pump with the maximum diameter. It should be always below the maximum diameter. So what was the reason? What is the reason for it? In case, if that particular pump, when you put that pump into operation, there is a possibility that always your calculation will not be exactly the same as that actually when you put the pump into operation. There can be some pluses and minuses, right? If the design point, design duty head is lower than the actual, you should be able to increase the pressure without changing the pump and the motor sometimes. So what is the only way that you to do that? To increase the impeller diameter. In case if you have select the pump with the maximum diameter, there is no way that you can increase the head, because you have gone to the maximum diameter level at the very beginning. Be careful on that, because sometimes we have come across such problems when the pump is in the operation. Some cases that pressure is not sufficient. It's not the problem with the pump, but with the design, what they have done, they have approximated, because all the time when you do a design, you may have to do some approximation as well. You have to keep some safety factors here and there, but actual will be not the same as the design what you did. So in that case, there is always flexibility for you to do some changes in terms of increasing the pressure. If it is the decrease the pressure, no problem, you can reduce the diameter, but there's no way that you can increase the diameter once you get the pump with the exact diameter what you have asked for them to do. Then only way to do is change the impeller. Change the impeller, there should be a sort of a gap, because you have not, you will not be, I mean, you, if you have not selected that particular point with the maximum diameter, you will have the possibility to change it to the higher diameter impeller, right? So keep that particular thing in mind, right? Because those are the important things that you need to be considered when selecting a pump. Sometimes you will never know whether that particular pump has been selected in between the maximum and the minimum. In case if it is in the maximum diameter level, you are having some risk, right? So keep that in mind. And if you see this capacity 130 and 30, if you have a calculator with you, just calculate the power requirement by the pump, just multiply 130 into 30, right? And multiply the specific gravity according to this particular pump at the liquid temperature 20 Celsius degree, the specific gravity has been given 0.9983, and divided by 367 as per the equation given before, right? You will get a value called 10.6 something kilowatt, and the efficiency of that particular point is 71.6. That means you have to divide that value by 0.716. You will get the value called 14.81 kilowatt. That is the power absorbed by the pump when the pump is running at that particular point. It's that much easy as that. So it's a matter of doing a small calculation there, so that you can make sure the kilowatt rating what they have mentioned there is correct or not. Right? So in case if somebody makes some modification here, you will easily identify it with the doing calculation by your own. Right? So these are the information you will get. And another parameter is called maximum power. Right? That is the power which will be absorbed by the pump when the pump is running at that particular end point. Even for this particular curve, you will see the runout point over here. The corresponding power value of this particular point, if you get that particular value from the power curve from here, you will get a value that is the value called 16.87. I'm not quite sure whether you can see it properly, but if you go by this particular point and corresponding value, if you get it from here, it's 16.84, right? This is that particular value. And I will come to NPS is required the later time. And now you have different information and different important parameters when it's come to the pump selection, right? So we'll go to the next slide. Okay. Now there's another two pump performance curve. Only difference is that the same capacity and same head. Here also the same 120 and 30 meter. But one curve is with low RPM, that is four pole motor, and the other one is with high RPM, right? So you will see two performance curve. One is with low RPM and the other one is with high RPM. When you do two different selection with high RPM and low RPM, you will get a different value in terms of efficiency, in terms of power requirement, in terms of impeller diameters. You can see when the speed is low to deliver this particular capacity, you may have to have a bigger diameter. That is, the impeller diameter over here is 305 millimeter. Whereas, same capacity and head will be delivered with the high RPM at 164 millimeter diameter. Now you will understand diameter, when the diameter is increased, you will get higher flow rate and the higher head. Similarly, when you increase the RPM, that is the speed, again the same principle will be applied. And the maximum head, that is the shutoff head, you will get it from here. Its value shown in 34.96. This is again somewhere close to 34.14. And if you go into this way, you will see there's a big difference in that particular maximum power, 17.35. There, whereas this is 15.82. How come this particular big difference came? Because you will see when that particular runout point, when it reached to that particular point, efficiency drops not much. It is above 60 for this particular curve. And this one, for the runout point, it is dropping somewhere close to 50. So when the efficiency drops, automatically power will be increased, right? For the same, both the pumps, you will see the rated power is 18.5 and 18.5. Sometimes you may have some question about the kilowatt, because the power required by this particular pump is 13.75. Why it is not possible to go with 15 kilowatt motor? That may be a question that somebody can ask. The reason behind is, whenever you put the pump into operation, you are not 100% sure that particular pump will operate at that particular point all the time. It's a possibility that particular point can move along this particular curve here and there. For that, you need to have a sort of a safety margin for the motor, right? It should be at least 20% of that particular duty point power. Some people say 15%, but 15 is very close to the particular duty point, because if there's any difference in the head, you will have a problem with overloading the motor. So you have to make sure to have at least minimum 20% power reservation for the motor when you select the motor, right? Some cases, if that particular 13.75, so 13.75 into 1.2, 20% margin is about 16.5. Right? You will not have any motors with 16.5 kilowatt. You will have the next available motor is 18.5. It doesn't mean that you will supply 18.5 kilowatt into the system. It is not. It may run at the part load condition, where the actual head, the power requirement is somewhere around 13.75, somewhere close to that. So be careful on that as well. Sometimes people might do some people will play with all these kilowatt and everything to be competitive in the pricing, and sometimes they do consider only that particular duty point kilowatt, not considering the tolerance on running the pump with a different duty point, right? Okay, and you will get a lot of information, as I explained before, in case requirement, the maximum power to efficiency head, many many things you can get it from here, and you can just have a look on each and every parameter. And those information may be useful for you to select the other things as well. Okay. And you will get a family curve like this. It's give you a clear picture for each and every different pumps model, which capacity and which head you can be achieve with that particular model. Let's say if it is this particular model, let's say 50-200, this particular range, you can have this flow rate, and this particular head can be achieved with this particular model. If the capacity is higher, you may have to go with the other family. And if it is much more than that, you have to go with this one. If the head is higher, you have to go into this level. Similarly, each and every time you may have to refer the family curve in order to get a clear picture, so that you can straight away go into that particular model rather going one by one here and there. You can get it from the family curve. That will be easy access for you to straight away looking for the model for you to get that particular pump required, suitable for your application. Okay. And the pump performance curve and radial thrust. Okay. Forget about everything. Just have a look on this particular area. The green line, you always have referred this one particular point, best efficiency point. And they have given sort of an area where you could run the pump without any issues. It's the area we call preferred operating range. In case if your pump duty point is going here and over there, you will have lot of issues with the can be bearing failures, can be high noise, can be vibrations. There are many things can be happen if you are working that particular pump out of this particular range. So that is because of the, you will see the radial thrust. If that particular area always radial thrust is not much higher, but if you go beyond this particular point, you can see the radial thrust applied on the bearings and all is going to be high. So you will have a lot of issues with that. So make sure not to run that particular pump in out of this particular range. So that range, I will tell you how you can demarcate this particular range. And this is the curve, ISO curve, that with the equal efficiency level, we call it ISO efficiency curve. They are on this particular curve at any point have the same efficiency level. Even if 45, this is the 45 efficiency. Likewise, you will get the efficiency equally on any point of this particular curve, right? And when you calculate the system curves, I'm not going to talk about calculating system curves, how to do the design and everything. If you are getting involved in this design part of it, you must be very much aware about calculating all these head damp, friction losses, everything. This is just an equation for you to have a better understanding on this, because it's really time permits for me to elaborate each and every calculation part of it, but I prefer to go with the practical aspect of the same. And when you do a system curve, resistance curve, it's something like this. You will get the static head from this point, and from there to here, it's the dynamic system head. We call it system resistance curve. And pump will be selected on the intersection point of this particular system head, system curve, and the pump curve, the point which is intersecting, we call it the operating point, right? You will see the best efficiency point somewhere there. It's to the left hand side, and it's best efficiency point, and you will get that static head is from here and the dynamic head from there. Okay. And as I explained to you, these parameters, flow versus head, power, efficiency, will be given with the pump curve. Okay. Just focus on this particular curve, you will see when the duty point over here and the best efficiency point over here, there's a difference in efficiency as well. See, the best efficiency point over here, duty point is over there. There is an efficiency drop. And with that efficiency drop, what will happen? The power also increase up to a certain level. So that you have to make sure whenever your flow rate is increased, the power is increased substantially, because it's a function of the power as well. So you have to be very careful in selecting the duty point. And the preferred working range can be analyzed in this way. If you look at this particular picture, if the best efficiency point is over here, this is the efficiency. You have to select the pump. Always you have to select the pump 120% of that particular duty point, the best efficiency point capacity within that, and 70% of that particular point capacity of this particular pump. So it is not recommended to operate the pump continuously at flows lower than 70%, that is 0.7 into Q optima, and to not to run that particular pump higher than the 120, that is 1.2 into Q optimum value. So as long as you run the pump within that particular rate, always the pump durability will be higher, and you will not have any issue with the pump when you run the system. If not, you will find it in a different the definition in the same way. That is another criteria defining safe and continuous operating area, is that pump efficiency is not lower than 80% of the best efficiency point. If that particular point efficiency is 80%, 80% into another 0.8, 0.8 into 0.8, when that particular criteria fulfill, again you will have the same shape of the preferable working range. It's the same thing like that, but denoted by different parameters. This one we are talking about the Q optimum and the percentage of Q optimum. This one the percentage of best efficiency value. So as long as if you run this particular pump during this particular within this particular range, you are very much safe. But that is not mainly applicable for the fire application. I'm always this up to this level. I'm talking about the air conditioning application, water transfer application, and other water supply application. But when it's come to the fire application, it's a bit of a different principle will be applied. So I will tell that particular thing about in the later slides. Okay, now it's very clear for you to better. Graphically, you can see this is the desirable operation rate, 120% of the best efficiency point capacity and up to 70% of the best efficiency point capacity. Okay, and what will happen if you operate the pump continuously out of this particular range? These are the problems. There can be temperature increase of the pump housing, increase in radial and axial bearing load, circulation of the inlet. These are the issues. When it's come to this side, that out of this 120% of the capacity, you will have high NPSA requirement, low efficiency, and increase of radial bearing loads, motor overloading, because when the capacity is high towards your right side, power required by the pump and the motor is high. And this is the issues, that these are the problems that can be happen with the pump operated at out of this particular preferred working range. And this is again the same to the other side also. So I'm rushing through this because of the time. And NPSA. So this is really important factor that you all have to be considered in selecting the pump and doing a design. You have to make sure this NPSA requirement to be fulfilled. There are two things, that one is called NPSH required and the other one we call it NPSH available. NPSH availability should be always higher than the NPSH required. When it's come to NPSH required, it will be given by the pump manufacturer with the curve, right? So you, whenever you get a curve, you will have that particular graph. For the one particular duty point, you will get the value from the graph itself as NPSH required. And for the availability, you have to calculate by analyzing your insulation and then how that particular pump will be installed and location, everything has to be considered. That particular calculation can be done with this particular equation where I will show it to you in a better way. This is the symbol, the availability calculation. You will see. Let's say if that particular thing is the positive suction one, right? So you will have to use the availability to calculate the availability. That is the barometric pressure, that is the atmospheric pressure applied on this, and PD is the vapor pressure. And it's velocity pressure, and the viscosity, the friction losses. This is the minus value, because it will not be contributed for the flow. We call it friction loss, and the height of that particular. This is positive because the suction is positive, and this the negative suction one. You can see only difference is that this level difference is considered as a minus value. Okay. Simply, if you simplify this particular equation, NPSH availability equal to, let's say the atmospheric pressure is 10 meter. That is the 10 meter water column of weight will be considered as atmospheric pressure. That is 1 bar 10 meter. 10 minus basically this particular height, right? And the total friction loss along this particular pipe, and the velocity of this particular reservoir, velocity head, and the vapor head. So it's not much difficult for you to calculate. You can do approximate calculation to do to check the availability. And if you know the availability, if you compare this with the required, you can see whether that particular pump can be operated without any cavitation effect. Cavitation will definitely take place if the availability is lower than the required. For sure, you will not be able to run the pump. There are certain cases where people complain about it is not running. We cannot run the pump, purely because most of the time the reason is that the availability is not as per the requirement. So you may have to change the location of the pump, or you have to move that particular pipeline, you have to do some changes in the pipeline, many modification has to be done, right? And this is the law which will be applicable for the pump, right? It's very much easy, and get more lot of information with that. This is the curve, the parallel curve with the spring. So you can see the system, the curve here. This is the different curves with the speed. When the speed is high, you will get high capacity Q1 and high. In case if you select the pump at one particular speed, if you want to know the what would be the flow rate and the head, in case if you increase the motor speed, you can easily get that particular value from using this particular affinity law. So if you know the change speed, that is N2, N1 is the selected speed, and Q1 is the original flow rate. If you put that particular value over, you will get the actual Q2 when you increase the motor speed. Now you will see when the motor, the speed, the pump rotating speed, the RPM will be increased. When you increase it, automatically Q and H will be increased. Even the power and the head will be the same way increased with that particular formula. And the similarly, even if you increase the diameter, same thing will happen. For the lower diameter, you will get lower Q and H. For the same pump with the higher diameter, you will get a higher Q and higher H. So this is normally the applicable for any pump, centrifugal pump, with regards to the diameter and the speed. If the diameter is increased, Q and H will increase, even the power will be increased. Similarly, if you increase the speed of the particular pump, the same thing will happen. And the viscous, when you pump the high viscosity pump, the same thing will restriction will be applied, so that you will see the power might be changed with the viscosity when the viscosity change, but it's not something that I'm focusing, because we are always working with the water. There is no problem with the viscosity when you do apply when you do pump with the water. And this is how you have to control in case if that particular selection is not into the right way. Let's see if you have selected the pump with a particular point called B1, right? So that is the actual, if you want to move that particular point towards the higher side of this rate, you can throttle the valve so that you will apply additional friction into the system. That friction will change your system curve like this. This is the fully open, sometimes, let's say fully open point. Then when you close the valve, that particular system curve move towards your left hand side and you will get a different point with that. So these are the options available in case if you want to control the flow by means of a closing the valve, right? But it's a waste of energy as well, but there's no other way. In case if you have to do it, you have to throttle the valve and get it back to the particular point, to the required point. And if you consider a pump curve, can be three types. One is a dropping curve like this, and the flat curve and the steep curve. Always prefer to have the steep curves for the air conditioning and water supply application, whereas flat curve is more preferred for the fire application. Why it is so? Because the reason is that in case of a fire pump, big change in head versus small capacity changes are unwanted. You don't need sort of a small capacity change. You don't want to get a higher head change, so that you can refer the flat curve like this. For the flat curve, you will see for a small head drop, you get higher capacity changes. So for the fire pumps, it is not a problem at all. But for the other application, if the head drop is low, you should have the low capacity change. Otherwise, the duty point will be very far away from the best efficiency point or the duty point. So you will always have to use the steep curve for the air conditioning and the water application, whereas for the fire application, always go with the flat curve. Okay, so there are some other ways of doing some adjustment of pump performances. You can do it the throttle control. You can throttle the valve so that system curve will change and be modify the duty point to here, and similarly the power also will be changed. And you can do the other way, the bypass control, where you will have a bypass pipe connected to the suction side again, so that the flow rate would be higher and you get change that particular duty point to the modified duty point. And again, the relative power consumption, that is for the modifying impeller diameter. So impeller diameter, as I explained earlier, when the impeller diameter is reduced, you get a different pump curve. Then that particular point will be giving a different kilowatt rating, the lower kilowatt rating. And the last one is speed control. Again, I have already explained it to you. When the speed is reduced, you get the reduced QNH. By means of doing this, you will get the low power. And the parallel operation, this is how the parallel operation will take place. So I'm rushing through these. These are so much of theory part of it. And the series operation, when the pump is connected series. So it's like this. So you will get the combination curve like this, combined curve. And I will move to the fire system, because again, the part of building application. So there are different type of pumps will be used for the different different segment. Like when you have a sort of a positive suction, so you may have to use either one of these. But in case if you are not in a position to take the pump water as a positive suction, you can use this vertical turbine type pump. It's hardly used in our context, but it's possible to use those pumps also for that. And for the according to the fire application, so it's always you have to use with the interior material bronze or SS, and the shaft should be stainless steel, and the casing material can be cast iron or the cast nodular cast iron or anything which is mentioned over here. But always impeller should be bronze or stainless steel, and shaft always stainless steel. And the pump sealing is always the packing, not gland packing, not the mechanical seal. And the packing also has to be given by the 30 drips per minute when the pump is running, because it that cooling will be taken place with this particular water dripping. So you have to make sure that you will get that particular drops when the pump is running, and it has to be drained off at the bottom of that particular pump. Somewhere here, there's a point. You have to connect that particular point with the pipe and drain off from there, right? And for the NFPA requirement, this is the requirement for the performance requirement. So always refer this one. What it is given is this one. When the duty point is this, the particular pump should deliver, when the pump is deliver 150% of the design flow rate, it should be always higher than the 65% of the pressure head at the duty point. You can see if this particular point is 1500 gallons per minute, I will go back to the previous one, it's easy. Let's say the 100 cubic meters power at 100 meters head, this is the duty point of that particular fire pump. That particular pump should be able to deliver 150% of the flow rate at the 65% head level, right? So that particular criteria should be fulfilled for the fire pumps, and shut off it should be always lower than 140% of that, right? So this is the criteria to be fulfilled for the fire pump, right? Okay, and that's the same. And the motor power shall be selected for reaching the pump operating point at 150%. That is what is mentioned here. 150%, you will get a high power over there. That motor has to be selected based on the minimum motor power at the 150% of capacity. When the capacity is high, as I explained to you before, you will have to have a high power supplied by the motor. Then the motor should be selected more than this particular point. So if you select the motor below this particular power, it is not the recommended for the fire application. And there can be two type of motors, or open dip proof type and totally enclosed plan pool type. So it depends on that requirement. I'm just rushing through this. And the jockey pump also will be selected based on the main pump rated flow. If the capacity is, the main pump capacity is 1000 gallons per minute, the jockey pump flow would be 1%, up to 10%, it can be go up to 10%, but 1% is the minimum requirement. So it can be even 10% higher, you can go up to 10%. And jockey pump head should be 10 PSI higher than the main pump head. This is how that particular fire system works. When the pressure is dropped, jockey pump starts and it will increase the pressure of the system. Similarly, it will go like this, and when the fire happens, it will be somewhere in this particular point. So it's a graphical way of explaining this particular operation. And I have to go to the one other important part. Okay, this is the motor nameplate. So whenever you select the pump, you have to select the motor, and with that particular motor, there are many information that you can gather from that, right? You can see a lot of information in the nameplate. I don't think that most of the people, they don't care about this motor detail, but it is really important. There are so many informations, and we will directly related with the pump application as well. Especially this efficiency class, let's say it is IE2, here it's a IE2 class, and the insulation class, here it's a class F, and the duty class, continuous duty S1, and the IP, the protection class, index of protection IP55, and the other details, efficiency value and the cost 5 and the power factor and the speed. These information are very important, because if you go to this particular thing, as per the new regulation in Europe, it has to be The minimum efficiency level should be IE2 for the pump drive with the variable speed drive. In case if the pump is directly run with the direct supply or the star delta without VFD, the minimum efficiency class is IE3. That has to be fulfilled, especially for the Europe. They are not, they are not allowing anybody to install any motors below IE3 efficiency class. So that it is a mandatory requirement from 2017 to have IE3 motors, or else IE2 plus variable speed drive. Right. So our case, sometimes we do use IE3 plus variable speed drive. That is much better. That is much better. You will get much efficiency level if you go with IE3 plus VFD drive. That is, again, you will see this. There are some criteria. Earlier it was IE2 for up to 2015, but 2017 it has been changed to IE3, and IE4 efficiency class motors are also available at a very high, substantially higher price. But if you go by this curve, you will see the efficiency, how the efficiency will be changed. The early stage it was IE1, the motor efficiency class, and after that it was changed to IE2, right? You will see that little higher efficient, and now IE3, right? The changes are not much, but when you compare the IE3 and IE4, it's almost close, but the price difference is fairly high. So if you go with the IE3, that will definitely give you much better efficiency at acceptable price level. If you go by the IE3, yes, it's much efficient than IE3, but not big difference when compared. You will not get much benefit when compared to the price difference. So you have to be careful on that. But IE3 is the minimum requirement nowadays for the motors, especially for the air conditioning application, because the major component will be consumed by energy. Is the main concern for the air conditioning application, whereas you may have to go with IE3 minimum efficiency class. Should not allow anybody to go with IE2 because it's low efficiency level. And you will see that when the motor kilowatt is higher, the efficiency gap is very low. For the smaller kilowatt rating, yes, there is a substantial difference in each and every IE classes, efficiency classes. But when it's come to somewhere close to 75 kilowatt, 110 kilowatt, the difference is in the efficiency, it's very minimal. Okay, you will see the previous time I already informed you that when you select the motor, keep the 20% the power reservation when you select the motor against the duty point. That is because if you select the motor, another reason is that if you select the motor very close to that particular duty point, the motor is running at a full load. That is 100% full load, right? But if you look at this particular graph, almost all the time, you will see the 75% load is the highest efficiency level you will achieve from that particular motor. That means even if you put 15 kilowatt, if you run the motor at 75% load, 15 into 0.75, that is somewhere around 11.25 kilowatt, you will get much efficiency from the motor side as well. You will see each and every item, the efficiency is higher for the 75% load, whereas the 100% is little lower than that. So that way also you will get much better efficiency with the part load, not the 50%, but 75% of that particular load. And the insulation class also some important factor when you run the pump in the highly temperature environment. And the IP protection is again very important. That gives what the protection level that the motor will be given to you in terms of dust and in terms of liquid. This is the table that you can get this information about the dust protections and the protection from water. If you take the submersible pumps, submersible motors are always IP68 because it should be fully protected by the dust and fully protected by the water because it's submerged. All the submersible motors should be IP68, right? And the other motors which are mounted on the surface level, minimum would be 54, but almost all the cases 55 is much better in terms of index of protection. And this is for your information. I'm finishing it off within 5 minutes time. And the proper insulation system for the layout, it's always recommend to have one higher diameter than the pump nozzle size for the insulation, right? And this is the important, you will see it is preferred to be one size higher than the suction nozzle size. Its length should be as less as possible. When you reduce the suction pipe as much as possible, it is always contributed to run the pump in a proper manner. And it should reach the pump with least possible number of direction. It's really important not to have so many bends, so many fittings, so many valves within the suction pipeline. That will definitely create so much of the friction into the system. And there's a possibility to trap the air inside these bends and all, which will definitely create the cavitation effect on the pump. So you have to be very careful in that. And this is how that particular suction should be connected. If it is the positive, it should be angle in the way that is mentioned, that shown in the picture. And if it is the negative suction, the other way around. And this is how you should install when you, as mentioned in the previous slides, it should be always one step higher than the suction diameter. If it is 3 inch, you have to use 4 inch pipe. So that you have to use a reducer in that. For the suction side, it always should be eccentric reducer, not concentric, because this is where that air can be trapped. If you use concentric reducers, there is a possibility that air can be trapped over here. That is not favorable for the pump. If it is a negative suction, it should be the other way around. It's a concentric again, but the top is flat. The previous one, the bottom is flat. You will see. Here, the top is flat. But again, this is eccentric reducer. And these are some hints and the guidance that will be given in case of when you use this particular suction, what is the length to be maintained and what is the size of that particular pipe. And all these information will be given some support to run the pump in a smooth manner without giving any trouble. And when you put the water inlet into the sump, always put it into the bottom level, otherwise that the water mix with the air over here and that will be taken from the pump. That will create some vapor pressure in that, and it is again will be a problem for the damaging the impeller as well. These are the reason that why it is important to have this suction line connection has to be maintained such a way that it will give a proper function of the system. And again, how the discharge pipe and the suction pipe should be connected to the system. And again, this is the typical insulation diagram of a pump, where the negative suction systems always use only the foot valve, no any fittings over here, no valves, no strainers, nothing, because having many fittings in the pipeline have a lot of restriction to suck the water to the pump. So not to have anything is the best way to do the insulation for the suction side, especially for the negative suction. You have foot valve with the strainer, that is more than enough. And all the others are just pipe and connected directly with the one particular bend to the pump. This is the best way of doing the insulation for the pump. And for the positive suction, always have the strainer because it will be automatically fed to the piping system. because there's no way that you have to suck the water, because it automatically will give the positive feed to the pump where you can have a strain and suction valve. Suction valve is required whenever you do the repair work. You can close the system, isolate the pump from the system, otherwise you have to drain off the entire water from the system to do a sort of a repair for the pump. Having this particular valve, you can close it from there, you can remove the pump and do whatever the repair and put it back, so that the entire water will not be drained off, it will be remain in the system, while this water, only this particular area and this particular area will be drained off for sure, because when you remove the pump, it will happen. And that's all about the presentation, and thank you for your patience. And it's time for you to ask any question with regard to the presentation or anything related to the pump.
Thank you, Engineer Sajiva. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. This is Dilan Tilanga from Building Services Engineering Section Committee. And I'll be forwarding whatever the questions that you have to our presenter. So far, I got few questions. And meantime, you will forward your questions. I'll forward the question that I have to Engineer Sajiva. Engineer Sajiva, first question is, some applications are having vertical inline pumps without mountings.
Okay.
Is it brand specific?
Not really, because there are some cases where the vertical inline pumps can be directly connected with the pipe. There's no requirement to be have sort of a mounting on the base plate or the concrete base, as long as that particular pipe can be withstand that particular weight of the pump, right? Because it's not a must, right, to install it on the bottom or the concrete base plate. But there are some manufacturers, they do manufacture specifically those pumps without any mounting on the concrete. That is possible. Even for any vertical inline pump can be straight away mounted on the pipeline itself, but it's better to have some sort of a support from the pipe to withstand that particular weight of the pump.
Right. Next question. What happens to the pump if the delivery pipe is burst near the pump? Will it affect to the motor?
What do you mean by the delivery pipe?
Delivery pipe is, right? Yeah.
Okay. What will happen when the pipeline is blasted? So if that particular blasting will take place at the near to the pump, what will happen? There's no load into the pump. So that means the system head is very low, because there's no water going into the system. The head is very low. So it will definitely deliver high capacity from that particular burst point. And that particular point, you will see according to the performance curve, when the flow is very high, when there's no head in the system, the power required by the pump is very high. So there is a possibility that the motor will be overloaded. Not because of anything, because of draining high current, because the power required by the pump is very high, because there's no system head generated against the pumping of this water.
Next one, what may be the possible root causes for the excessive vibrations caused during the operation of pumps in some installations, and what are the corrective measures?
Actually, if you have already went through my presentation, so I have shown some preferred working area. When you run the pump out of that particular area, there's always possibility to have sort of a vibration. Right, because it is not desirable to run that particular pump continuously at that particular point. And other reason is that if you have not done a proper alignment for the pump and the motor, let's say if it is a in-suction pump, so before to start up, you have to have sort of a proper alignment of the pump and the motor with the coupling. You have to do the sort of alignment. So it has to be very carefully checked whether the alignment has been done properly. If there's any misalignment in that, obviously pumps will vibrate and that particular problem will occur. And reason is that better to have a proper alignment process, and again need to have sort of expansion joint in the piping system. Sometimes people may not really understand the vibration will not be created by the pump itself. It's sometimes created by the pipeline. When you do not have a proper insulation with that particular required bracketing and everything to support that particular the pipeline and separated from the pump with the expansion joint, right? So it will definitely transfer whatever the vibration. If the pump is vibrating, that vibration will transfer it to the piping system. It can be the other way around. The vibration, when the flow is moving in a pipe, there is a possibility the vibration will take place if there is no any proper support in that. So we have to be considered all these factors.
Right. Next one, in an existing pumping installation, how we practically determine whether the pump is operating as at its optimum operating point or not?
That is, it totally depends on where you would be able to get this particular reading, right? So if you have found any pump which have any doubt about their performance, the best way to check the performance is to check the shutoff head, right? Because if that particular pump is operated or that particular pump is supplied with the correct diameter, when you close the shutoff valve and run the pump, you will get the pressure value which should be equal to the shutoff head. If that shutoff head will not be achieved with that, then the pump supplied by the whoever the party has not been supplied with the correct diameter. Because no flow condition, that shutoff head should be achieved by the pump. So that is one way. If you want to make sure that particular duty point will be, the pump will be working at the duty point, only way to do it, you have to check the flow and the pressure. So it is the way that you have to check the performance of the pump. You have to measure the flow rate at that particular pressure, what you have asked for. You have selected the pump based on the Q and A. If you set the pressure to that particular pressure value, and when you check the flow rate at that particular point, that flow rate should be given.
Okay, next one. Up to which frequency we can reduce the speed of the pump with the help of the VSD?
Okay, it's a good question. If it is continuous running, always recommended to have the minimum frequency less 30 hertz if it is continuous running. But if you want to run occasionally even at a 0 to 50 hertz, no problem. You can do anytime, but for the short period of time. But if you are running the pump continuously at a very low frequencies, there are certain things can be happen, even the cooling effect. Because when the motor is running, these motors are fan cool motors. If you reduce the speed of the motor, the similarly that particular fan rotation speed also very low. That particular the airflow will not be there for the cooling system. So that is another reason that you should not reduce very much low frequency value for the continuous run.
Okay. Next one, what is the lifetime of a pump in a typical building application?
I think it is, I cannot say exactly this is the number of years that you could use this pump. There are pumps which are being used for sometimes more than 20 years, but there are pumps which can fail within 2-3 years time. That is totally depends on how you do the maintenance work for the pump and the insulation and all whatever the required services to be done on time, it depends on that. There are so many the other factors which will definitely affect for the lifetime of that particular pump. So it but the major components such as impeller casing and the shaft, the main component will not damage for even for 20 years. You can run without any problem. But other the consumable, this thing like bearings, rubber couplings, the mechanical seal bearings, those sometimes has to be replaced based on the requirement.
Next one, what will happen if the size delivery line connected to the pump delivery mouth? Example, 6-inch line to 4-inch delivery pump mouth.
There is no problem at all, because if the diameter is higher than the diameter of the pump, it's always better for the performance of the pump. If it is reduced, if the diameter is lower than the diameter of the pump, then you will have a problem. So if it is bigger, it's the best way to have that particular system run.
All right. Next one. Are these pumps that can be compatible and non-compatible with VSD? What is the difference between those?
Exactly. So that is normally the motor should be compatible. Motor should be compatible to run with PFD. That recommendation has to be taken from the manufacturer. There are some motor manufacturers. They do manufacture motors which are not compatible with VFD. So that is always you have to check whether this motor what you use for this application is compatible with the VFD drives, because I hope nowadays almost all the motor manufacturers, they do manufactures motors which are compatible with VFD drive for sure. Not like early days, they do have a different the product segment for the VFD compatible and not compatibles. But nowadays, almost all the motor manufacturers, they do manufacture their motors with VFD compatible things, because otherwise they are not in a position to survive in the market without.
Next one, what is the difference between fully enclosed and half enclosed impeller?
It's the impeller design. I did not show it to you here. There are four types. It's closed impeller, semi-open and fully open. Because when you take an impeller, there are vanes inside, right? That will be covered from the both sides. That is closed impeller. There are some impellers where the one side of that particular impeller will be open, the vanes are there, but only at the one area only covered with that. So if I have time, I can show it to you, but it takes time for me to find it. There are three types of impeller, but normally the product which we use for the water application, like the water transfer, the fire, or the air conditioning, those are closed impellers, no open impellers at all. Open impellers will be used mainly for the submersible pumps, where the particles will be pumped along with the water so that it won't clog inside the impeller. To not clog these impellers, they open one the side of that particular impeller. We call it open impeller, and semi-open impellers as well. So it depends on the application. For the submersible pump, yes, most of the impellers are semi-open or the fully open type.
Next one. According to which signals will the VSD operate?
Sorry, I didn't get you.
According to which signals will the VSD operate?
Normally, VFD, even in booster systems, I would say booster water pumping system, it's always refer the pressure. The pressure transducer will give you the signal, pressure signal, and that signal will be considered as the input for the VFD. If that particular pressure signal is high, that will give us the high pressure. That means they will reduce the frequency with the signal. That can be again coupled with some other parameters like temperature. It depends on how that particular pump should be operated. So if you want that particular pump to be operated based on the some other parameters like temperature, that is also possible. You need to get that particular signal and give the VFD 4 to 20 sort of a signal and run the VFD according to your application. But mainly, most of the cases, pressure is the signal which will be taken as the input for the VFD drive.
That's all that we got through Zoom chat. So okay. I think we can allow a few of the raise hand questions.
Sure.
Yeah.
Mr. Sajeev.
Yes.
Yes, I want to know about what are the factors we considered about before purchasing the water pumps, major factors.
For what application you are referring?
The normal house construction or something normal.
Normal water pumps for the filling of your tank or something like that?
Yes, filling of tank.
Okay. If it is a domestic application, so we are talking about very small pump where the motor rating would be half horsepower, I would say about 1 horsepower maximum. Where if you consider the sort of a power requirement, if your main concern is the power, you always need to check the efficiency class of the motor, right? But the mainly for the selecting of that particular pump is totally based on your flow rate and the head. Because I will tell you the reason. Sometimes the people, even the layman, sometimes ask for the pump not by the flow rate and the head, but they do ask it from the size of the pump. Half inch. Okay, 3/4. I need a pump with half inch or 3/4 or 1 inch. But that is not the right way to ask for the pump. You have to ask for the duty requirements. How much of flow rate you require for that particular application? What is the pressure requirement of your application? If you know these two, you ask for that one. Not the size of the pump, even not the size of the motor. Some people ask for the horsepower. So some people say I need a half horsepower, 0.5 kilowatt. So that won't give any meaning for me. It's just a value which we normally talk about the motor. If you say the size of the diameter of the pump, it's another factor. It will not be the right way to ask for the pump. Only the best way to select the pump or to ask for the pump is you give your requirement of flow rate and the head requirement. Based on that, you have to select the pump. Is it the answer that you are expecting?
Yes, yes. Okay.
Right.
Hello, sir.
Yes.
There's a requirement to check the pump curve. During annual maintenance, fire pumps. Can you throw some lights how we are supposed to do that?
Uh-huh.
How to check the pump curve in annual maintenance?
Check the pump curve. What do you mean by check the pump curve?
That we have to every one year as per the NFPA maintenance requirement. We have to check the pump curve. check the pump curve. We have to check the conformity of the original pump curve.
Okay, so for that also, the best way to do it, you need to find the few points in that particular pump. For that, you need a sort of a flow meter, as well as you need to throttle the valve to get that particular different duty point, right? Let's say when you run the pump with a delivery valve, when you fully open that particular, that particular head value, you will get a flow rate this much, and you plot that particular point into your the x-axis and y-axis. You just mark the Q and the head, and when you can throttle the valve to a certain level and increase the pressure, and you get another pressure value, and that particular pressure value you can measure the flow rate. Similarly, you can plot few more points in that particular the curve, and you can connect each that particular point, you will get the performance curve basically, right? So as I explained to you earlier, if you want to make sure that pump which you were given by the manufacturer is correct, best way to check the shutoff valve. You close the entire valve and run the pump. See what is the pressure value which will reach with that particular pump, so that value should be same as what was given by the manufacturer as the shutoff valve. If that was achieved, more or less it is the same the pump that you were given by the manufacturer. There's no any other way that you can check it. If you check the shutoff valve, obviously, if the pump is correct, you should achieve that particular shutoff valve.
Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Engineer Sajeev, meantime, we got two more questions in the Zoom chat. What is the effect of the temperature for pump efficiency?
That more than the efficiency, it will affect for the pump performance. When the temperature is rising, you know, the vapor pressure will be high. So in order to avoid any cavitation effect, the lowest the pressure at the suction the point when the piping system should be always higher than the vapor pressure, right? So efficiency would not be the main concern with the temperature. It's the concern about the cavitation effect. So it has to be always the vapor pressure should be lower than that the point, the maximum pressure of that particular lowest point. Temperature will not be really affected for the efficiency, I would say, because as far as my knowledge is concerned, that will be affected for the performance of the pump. That's mean for the NPSH will not be fulfilled if the temperature is changing. So that is the answer I can give you to this.
Okay, the next one. Kindly explain the usage of external priming ejectors for applications with negative suction head.
Sorry, can you repeat that?
Kindly explain the usage of external priming ejectors for applications with negative suction head.
What do you mean, the rejector? I didn't really get that question.
Ejectors, priming ejectors.
Priming ejectors?
Yes. Yeah.
So negative suction always need, whatever the centrifugal pumps, when you run the centrifugal pumps, it is always required to be primed. That initial priming has to be done. You have to fill the entire suction pipe prior to the first starter. That has to be done, right? Once you do the priming, the pump, when the pump is running, there's no way that particular pump will have to prime again, unless if you have any problem with the suction piping, if there's any problem with the foot tail, you may have to prime it again. But the question what he was asking is about the priming of these pumps. Is that what he asked?
Yeah, priming ejectors. Usage of priming ejectors for applications with negative suction head.
Maybe the priming tank, no, they are asking.
Okay, the priming tank can be mounted for the suction side. That is basically to avoid any air sucking from the system, because when you connect it with that normal without the priming tank, what will happen? In case there's any small leakages in the pipeline, it will definitely suck the air into the system. If you have a priming system, it will automatically prime that getting that air into the system. It always keep on priming that particular entire system. Having a priming tank is definitely benefited for the system, but it's not always a must to have that particular priming system. So if you have that, it's an additional benefit for the performance of the pump.
Okay. Next one, what is the maximum NPSHR value we could find in the market?
NPSH required value.
Yeah.
That can be even, it can be 7.5, it can be, because it basically depends on the duty point. If you carefully looking at my performance curves and which I showed to you before, right? I will just to show it to you again. So I will go to this one particular curve. It totally depends on the duty point. It can be going up you will see this particular the point. The NPSH requirement is 3.15. It doesn't mean this particular pump will need only 3.15 at all the time. It will increase when that particular duty point going along this particular curve up to this level. For this point, you will see the NPSH requirement almost close to 6. Right? So that is why it is not easy for me to tell exact value. It's completely depends on the particular the duty point. If you go to this one, right, it's again more than 6 even for this particular point, right? The basically I can say as a approximate value the would be around 7. The maximum requirement would be around 7.
Okay.
Did I answer to your question?
I hope so. Yeah.
Yes. Thank you.
Yeah. Next one. What is the rough price difference between long couple and short couple and long couple and short couple end suction back pull out pumps?
Okay, it will be around 20%, around 20% price difference will be there for those two type of pump. Normally the close couple ones are cheaper than the long couple one, maybe around 20%. That is again depends on the size of the motor as well, but roughly I would say about 15 to 20% price difference will be there.
Right, next one. What is the efficiency level expected for fire pump application?
Okay, for the fire pumps application, we never talk about the efficiency because if you are to talk about the efficiency of the fire, I think it's really no use actually, because the fire pump will not use for the continuous running or any other a major contribution towards the day-to-day operation of the building. It's really required for the emergency sort of this thing. It's like when you have a fire only, it will come into the picture. So efficiency level, we normally don't talk about the efficiency for the fire pumps, I can say. It's more than the efficiency, it's always referred to the reliability. How reliable that particular pump is without any trouble, it should be able to operate at any particular time when there is a fire. So we never talk about the efficiency for the fire.
One more question, is the negative suction is allowed for the fire pump complying with NFPA 20?
No, no. For the NFPA 20, negative suction will not allow for any reason. Always it should be positive. In case if the positive suction cannot be achieved, that is why there is the type of pump called vertical turbine type, where the pump will be submerged and the motor will be mounted on top. So that pumps will be used for the fire application where the positive suction will not be possible to achieve. So negative suction will not allow in the UL and NFPA, but even the BS standards allow negative suction with the priming arrangement, which I already explained in the previous question.
All right, Engineer Sajeev, that was the whole question that we got from Zoom chat as well.
Okay.
I think we can allow one or two more raise hand questions if anyone have.
Installation and operation.
If we have about 2 minutes, I can run a sort of a video. If you allow me to do that, it will give you how the installation should be done for the pump with lot of things to be considered. So if it is possible, I can run this once the question and answer session is over.
Of course we can, of course.
Okay.
For horizontal and suction centrifugal pumps. This manual contains instructions for the installation, operation, and maintenance of the horizontal and suction centrifugal pumps. Welcome to the general video reference and guide. Please read the product manual before installing the machine to get knowledge of the pump works and how to install it. This is a brief overview and demonstration of the entire process covering the key points. Installation. Before installing the pump, ensure that the foundation on which the pump will be installed is prepared well. It has to be sufficient enough to take the weight of the pump and absorb any possible vibrations from it. The foundation has to be absolutely straight without any inclination. The foundation bolt of proper size should be embedded in the concrete and base plate. Piping associated with the pump must be supported independently of the pump and should never put any strain on the pump casing. When the pipes are not supported, their weight is covered by the pump casing, and this situation may cause cracks on the pump casing. It's important that the connections are aligned axially, angular, and in length carefully. Suction line, negative suction. The piping and the connection fittings should be properly aligned and supported separately. The elbow should be of long radius type. All suction pipe must be airtight. The suction pipe should be sized to ensure the liquid velocity not more than 2 meters per second. The suction pipe size should be at least one commercial size larger than the pump inlet. All suction pipes should have a continuous rise to the pump suction inlet. 6 millimeter to 100 millimeter slope is recommended. No isolation valve is recommended. There should be a pressure tap provided for installing a vacuum gauge in the suction line. The reducer joining the straight length of the pipe in the pump line should be an eccentric reducer with the inclined side of the reducer as the bottom side. The straight length of the pipe after the eccentric reducer should be 2 times the pipe diameter. The suction strength must be at least 4 times the suction pipe area, and the mesh size should screen out solid particles that would clog the impeller. The minimum depth of submergence of the strainer should be at least 3 times the pipe diameter measured from the upper row of holes strained. The distance between the bottom of the strainer and the floor of the tank should be 2 times the pipe diameter. Suction line, positive suction. In case the water is being supplied to the suction through gravity, a slightly different setup is needed. The elbow should be standard type or long radius type. Isolation valve should be provided in suction line. The pipe from the tank to the pump should have a descending inclination. The straight length of pipe between the pump inlet and tank should be at least 3 to 6 times the pipe diameter. The suction pipe should be sized to ensure the max liquid velocity of 3 meters per second. There should be a pressure tabing provided for installing a vacuum gauge in the suction line. The reducer joining the straight length of the pipe in the pump line should be an eccentric reducer with the incline, the side of the reducer, as the top side. Discharge line. There should be a pressure tapping as close to the pump outlet and before the isolation valve as possible to measure the pump shutoff head. Concentric reducer is installed in the discharge side to minimize the friction losses. To prevent reverse flow and protect the pump from hydraulic shocks, check valve has to be used in discharge line. The isolation valve is provided downstream of the check valve so that these can be taken up for maintenance, priming, and starting whenever required. Discharge pipe size should be at least 1 commercial size larger than the opening of the pump outlet. The number of fittings and size changes should be minimized to prevent fluid friction losses. Expansion joint may be used only after a careful piping analysis, especially when the discharge pressure are on the higher side. Installation of pump and prime mover. The pump unit needs to be fitted with using nuts and bolts before fitting in any pipes. The pump and the motor are aligned to the final tolerance using a reverse dial gauge or laser alignment tool. After the alignment is completed, the piping connected with the pump should be built. Once this is completed, the alignment of coupling should be rechecked. Then the alignment of all piping and fittings should be rechecked and suitable corrections should be made. The motor should be wired correctly to ensure the correct direction of rotation. When the pump and motor have been coupled, movement of the shafts should be controlled manually by hand to see if it is rotating smoothly. Pre-operational checks. After checking alignment of coupling, assemble the coupling guard and tighten the bolts. Ensure that the pump suction valve is fully open and all joints are checked for any leakage. The discharge valve should be kept closed to prevent overloading the prime mover. For further information,
okay, hello. That's all about this video. I just want to share that with that information, you can get a more a clear picture about how to do the installation of a pump and how the connection pipe connection has to be done for the proper function of the system. Thank you.
Can you send the presentation, Mr. Sajeev?
Yeah, it is possible. So I will send this to these sectional committee. So I don't know how they are going to send it to you. So that is the way that I can do it.
Okay, send the email.
So Ishan, so how the procedure that you follow for that sharing is?
Yes, Sajeev, we got the participants from the registration.
Okay.
And we have their email addresses. Then we will, through ISL, we will circulate them.
No problem. I will make sure to give entire the presentation along with the videos for the, you to send them in a way that you are doing for the others.
In this, Sajeev, meantime, we got one more question. I think it will be the last question of the day.
Okay.
It's a gentleman from a non-engineering background.
Okay.
He's asking that, can you elaborate how to use a booster pump on the same tray, same drain pipeline for a simple garden shower project. My purpose is to place a top-up tank and use that water using the same pipeline to drain out water with a high pressure using a booster pump. I better forward this question to your WhatsApp number.
Okay.
Meanwhile, let me read this again.
With a booster pump on a same pipeline for a simple garden shower project. The purpose is to top up a tank and use that water using the same pipeline to drain out water with a high pressure using a booster pump. I'm not really getting this question. What exactly? maybe because of he's explaining something which I'm not quite clear what exactly he wanted from me.
So I think it is like so they're using booster pump for garden shower application along with the general use of water.
Sir, I'm here. Can I speak up a bit?
Yeah, of course.
Sir, it's that we need to take 4-5 showers to the garden. And this showers needs to be a bit pressurized so that we can sprinkle a bit. To do that, sir, there is a well and we are trying to pull pump water using the existing centrifugal pump to the tank.
Okay.
So using the same pipeline, can we take down water from the tank using a booster pump to the opposite direction to pressurize these showers?
You are going to take the water from the tube below, from where you get the water?
From a normal well.
Normal well, and you will pump it to the tank, right?
Correct, sir.
Okay. From tank, you are going to get the water to the showers, is it?
Showers using the same pipeline because of the distance of the land. Mm-hmm. Using the same pipeline, we are going to send the water to the other direction once the tank is topped up.
Okay, you are going to do, I mean, what you wanted is to do that particular, the pump what you are already using, which will be using for the filling of this particular tank. And you are going to tap off that particular pipeline and take another pipe out from that particular main pipe and send it to the showers. Is that what you want?
Yes, sir. Send it to the showers, but we are going to use the same pipeline after the main pipe to bypass the main pipe using some valves.
Okay, so that same main pipeline which you have connected to the water tank will be tapped off and taken that particular pipe into the sprinklers or whatever the garden showers. Am I correct?
Correct, sir. Correct.
Okay, that is possible. The thing is this, you need to have some control mechanism where when the pump is, when the water tank is filled, you need to stop that particular filling by means of a ball float valve or some other mechanism, where once it is filled, that particular water will be diverted to your sprinkler system, whatever the garden shower system.
Yes,
that is possible. So what you have to do is you need to connect this particular the pipe to the water tank through the ball float valve or whatever the closing, once it is come to the closing position, that water will be diverted to your sprinkler, the garden system. So that is possible.
Right. Okay, sir. Thank you.
Thank you.
Right. With that, let's close the Q&A session for the day. And we'll move to the closer remarks of the day. And Engineer Ishan, over to you.
Thank you, Dilan. Actually, this is a very comprehensive technical session and a very elaborative Q&A session. Thank you, Engineer Sajio Pereira, for spending a valuable time. We know that you are a very busy person and you have some schedules also. So spending a valuable time and making us knowledgeable with your expertise in the field and practical as well as the theoretical knowledge, you have shown that how the pumping applications can be used in typical building applications. So I'm again very much thankful to your determination and cooperation with us to host the event very successfully. And also I would like to thank ISL and the technical staff of ISL by letting us the opportunity to host a webinar series after the corona pandemic situation. So again, I would like to thank, we have actually 150 plus participants today. That is a very massive crowd for this kind of a webinar in a short notice. So I would like to thank all the audience for being patient during the lecture and very much support you with the Q&A session. So we will take all the necessary actions to forward the presentation to you all through ISL. And again, if you have any questions or any other matter, you can always connect Building Service Engineer Sectional Committee or directly, I think, Mr. Sajeev also you can contact. Is it okay, Mr. Sajeev?
No problem. So I will share my email address to everyone. So
Also, ISL, for you have any further questions to be clarified. And again, I would like to thank all of you, especially Mr. Sajeeva and BD Service Engineer Sectional Committee members, Chairman, Engineer Sunil Fernando, for their valuable cooperation to us to host the event. So that is the end of the lecture today. So I would like to wish you a very good night and see you soon with this kind of another valuable lecture. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for inviting me for this session, actually, to Building Service Sectional Committee and ISL, as well as those who participated for the seminar. So thank you very much once again. So I'm very much happy to share my experience and knowledge with this much of crowd. Thank you very much. Good night.
Thank you.